Okay, welcome ladies and gentlemen. Before we start the session officially, we would need a minute of silence for Ms. Sabine Mahmood, who was shot yesterday through a hornet's incident. And after that, we'll start the session. Thank you.
The topic of our next session is winning the Pulitzer Prize. The speaker for the session is Paul Harding, and the session will be moderated by Shandana Minhas. Shandana Minhas is Pakistani English language novelist. Her first novel, Tunnel Vision, was shortlisted for the Commonwealth Writers Prize in 2008. Her second book, Survival Tips for Lunatics, won the KLF French Embassy Fiction Prize for 2015.
I'd like to introduce the person I will be in conversation with, Paul Harding. Paul Harding is an American writer. His first novel, Tinkers, won the Pulitzer Prize in 2010. His second novel, Enon, was published in 2013. In a previous incarnation, he was a drummer in a band. But he has since been writing and teaching creative writing at places including Harvard, and he's currently visiting faculty at the university, at the Iowa Writers Workshop at the University of Iowa, right? That's
right.
What it says.
Right. Yes.
Yeah. So the topic of our conversation is winning the Pulitzer Prize. Let me tell you a bit about the prize first. So the Pulitzer has been a prize awarded by Columbia University in New York since 1917 to honor excellence in journalism and the arts. It gets a lot of press because of the journalism awards. The financial prize itself for the arts are not so high. The financial rewards aren't so high, but the creative prestige is tremendous. Another interesting fact for the nationalists in the audience, the year that Paul won the Pulitzer, one of the finalists, the other finalist was Daniel Moinuddin, who was a Pakistani-American writer who wrote in Other Rooms, Other Wonders. So I'd like to begin, Paul, by asking you to tell the story of the 3 years before Tinkers was published.
Tinkers was the genesis for Tinkers was telling, basically recounting in fiction the stories that my maternal grandfather told me and my cousins about his life growing up in the state of Maine. He and my grandmother grew up very poor, had very, very difficult lives, made their way, as they would call it, from Maine down to Massachusetts, just near Boston, and so we always knew that they had very difficult lives, but we couldn't get them to elaborate on those lives. They had a kind of generational tact. Their attitude was what happened up in the woods stays up in the woods. With the consequence for me that those stories were all the more fascinating to me, interesting to me. So I began to write the book as a series of vignettes that had as their germs some little bit of family history that was factual, but there was so little fact that I wrote them up into imagined versions. I wrote them up into fictional versions. I worked on the story. I worked on the novel for three or four years, and when I was ready to have it published, I was quite confident of it being published because I had gone to the Iowa Writers Workshop, which in the United States is supposed to mean the publishers are going to come to you asking how big a check they can write you. And what I met with was unanimous rejection. Every editor and every agent to whom I sent the book said with varying degrees of civility no, or lack of civility. And the rejections were ranged all the way from just sort of photocopied anonymous, you know, dear Paul Harding, we thank you for sending your book Tinkers, you know, just sort of filled in on, you know, so, to sort of relatively long, personal, somewhat resentful letters about what an awful book this is, and under no condition should I or anybody else ever abet it in seeing the light of day. But it was interesting because my experience of those rejection letters is that, you know, artists all face rejection. It's part of our, you know, sort of the common lot. And what I found is that I rejected the rejection letters because within them, none of them cut me to the quick. I didn't recognize any of the rejections as legitimate. I had rejection letters that said that because of the frantic pace of life today, nobody wants to read a quiet, introspective, pastoral, meditative, metaphysical work of art. As I thought to myself, I do. And I also thought, you mean that frantic pace of life today about which every single person complains incessantly? I just thought my book will be an antidote to that. It will quiet your mind down and reintroduce you back to the fact that you have a mind. And then other people said nobody wants to read a book that's from more than one point of view. Nobody wants to read it. You know, they want a beginning and a middle and an end and a nice bow on the end, you know. And so I rejected the rejection letters. I threw the book into the desk, the proverbial desk in which we all have novels and paintings. And then it was just published by a series of accidents 4 or 5 years later by, of all places, at the time, just formed not-for-profit boutique literary press that was published solely at the philanthropic pleasure of the alumni of the New York University School of Medicine. And so, of course, when that happened, I said, "Why didn't I think of that in the first place?" You know, it was a real struggle. And by the time they accepted it, I thought, "Well, this will be great. I'll have 50 copies of it printed, and my mother will buy 45 of them, and then I'll give one to each one of my kids." But the silver lining to all that was that in the 4 or 5 years in between trying to get it published and not having it published, and then having it published, I had to sort of confront myself about what my motives were for making art. I really had to reconcile myself with the possibility, actually at the time, the stark fact of I was going to be a writer who made art for art's sake. And it was somewhat liberating because what it did was it freed me from second guessing what editors and agents wanted. I could just write whatever I wanted to, and it was very liberating in that respect.
Okay, you used the term noble pursuit in one of the interviews that I read.
Noble pursuit.
This going to be a noble pursuit?
Yeah, it had to be. I had to, you know, come up with something that made it sound, you know, righteous, the reason to keep going.
Did you, at any point when you were receiving these rejection letters, did you ever write back? I mean, you must have obviously written back in your head, but did you actually?
Well, I have to say, no, I never wrote back. But I do have to say that when the book won the Pulitzer, this sort of list of people went through my mind saying, "I told you, I told you, I told you, I told you." You know, I mean, you have to take it all. It's all just so absurd because winning the prize is just, it's almost statistically impossible to win it. Particularly being a first-time novelist, and the novel was so small, the last couple of the prize almost immediately reverted back to being given to hugely successful
with a huge budget behind them.
Novel, yeah, they do, and so the year that Tinkers won, there was a lot of gladness and joy among the kind of more independent publishing houses and independent bookstores, because I think what it did is it sort of illuminated or brought out from behind the veil of woe, you know, about commercial publishing and everything, that there actually are readers out there, and that, you know, Tinkers was until the Pulitzer was very much hand-sold and very much a grassroots book. People would read it and decide that they would take it to heart or not, you know. But the people who took it to heart took the time to buy 4 or 5 copies and give copies to their friends and their siblings and their family. And so it had a very beautiful kind of grassroots career. Before the prize, I would go and take any reading, public reading I could get, and two or three people would show up. And anytime anybody came up afterwards and said, "Oh, I'm going to get my reading group to do this," you know, in the United States, I don't know if they, in the United States, people get together, they have reading groups, so they're social groups that get together, and they, and so anytime anybody said to me, "Oh, I'm going to get my reading group to read Tinkers," I'd say, "If you live within 200 miles of my house, I'll drive there and I'll come to your house the night that you talk about the book." So I ate a lot of strange casseroles and drank Zinfandel and had heard a lot of criticism, constructive and otherwise. But
You know, you're being very modest, but I've made a few inquiries, subtle inquiries about you amongst friends who happen to be writers in America, and you're a hero because precisely of this journey. Your manuscript languished, you experienced awful rejection. Ultimately, it got to this publisher through word of mouth and through bookstores. The whole bookstore angle, we don't really have bookstores here. I mean, we have bookstores, but it's a bookstore where you go in and you choose for yourself. You guys actually have bookstores where people are dedicated, passionate. If you walk in, they will talk to you. They will help you. And
occasionally, that's true. It's these independent bookstores are constantly under threat. Just for various reasons, you know, real estate's too expensive. You have in the United States, you have places like Amazon, which has no, is not legally compelled in any way to limit the prices, so they can just, Tinkers in the United States is something like $15 for the cover price, and on Amazon you can buy it for like $4 or something. Mm-hmm. It's outrageous. But it was very nice, because then when the book won the prize and nobody had any idea in the world who I was. I mean, I still say to this day, I'm not a famous author. I've just written a famous book, and I sort of shepherded around. But it was a great backstory to be the sort of ambassador for, the deputy for, because it gave me the opportunity to go all around the world, really, and talk about the independent booksellers and talk about the independent publishers and just that whole just community of readers who really took it to heart and really sort of, it became a mutual thing. You know, the book had all of these sort of guardian angels who were just, you know, just very, very dedicated to getting it out and about. So it was very, very, it's a very humbling experience too, because, you know, it's a big deal. It's a much bigger deal than I ever thought it was. It is like winning the lottery, because, as you said, you know, there are two other finalists, but to basically be nominated for the Pulitzer Prize, your publisher has to send three copies of the book and a check that doesn't bounce, and then you're nominated. So there's something like several hundred books that are nominated every year, and there are three judges every year, and those three judges have to take three of those 700 books and then forward them to the Pulitzer Prize board proper, which is 18 or 19 people. And that, so you understand that when you, one understands when one wins the Pulitzer, you understand that when you win, it could have been any of a number, dozens of other incredibly artful, worthy books, and you just do a series of, relatively lucky breaks, won it.
Is it true, though, that somebody actually called your publisher and asked them to submit Tinkers and, in fact, waived the entry fee because it was a non-for-profit?
The backstory to that is there was a woman who was in one of these small bookstores, independent bookseller, who just took Tinkers to heart and tried to get everybody in the world to buy it. She happened to be taking a class at a local festival or on book editing, and handed the book to the woman who was teaching the class, who was a woman named Rebecca Sinkler, who, unbeknownst to her, Rebecca Sinkler had been the editor of the New York Times Book Review, the book review that comes out every Sunday. What this bookseller did not know was that she was the head of that year's Pulitzer Prize jury for fiction. So she read it and decided that she wanted to solicit the book so that the other judges could read it. Yeah,
that's fantastic. Yeah. Also, how did you find out that you had won?
Well, the Pulitzer Prizes are largely journalistic prizes, so they're run a little bit differently. Most book prizes in the United States have what they call like a long list, and then a kind of a long list, and then a sort of short list, and then a really short list. And what they do is they just they string out the nomination process for a long time because they want to sell books. They publicize books. The Pulitzers are primarily journalism prizes, so they just announce them. So I didn't, other than the fact that I knew that Bellevue, the publisher, had sent copies to the Pulitzer people, I didn't know anything about it. And so actually I was teaching out at the University of Iowa. I was teaching a seminar on Henry James, and I knew I was due to teach. It was a Monday afternoon. I knew they were going to announce the prize at 3 in the afternoon. I was due to teach at 4 in the afternoon. So I figured I'll go online. I knew they were going to announce the winner. And so I figured, well, you know, I'll go, I'll find out who it is. Maybe I even know who it is. And then I'll talk about the winner with my students, because as everyone knows, literary prizes are a rowdy spectator sport, you know. And every year, you know, they announce the winner, and half, you know, this side of the room says, oh, it's the end of art as we know it, you know, and the other half of the room says, art's safe for another year. So, you know, it's a very partisan kind of thing. And I remember the year before Tinkers had won, it was a woman named Elizabeth Strout had won for Olive Kittredge. So I logged on, and it was a little bit early, and so I was refreshing. So I kept saying, Elizabeth Strout, Elizabeth Strout, Elizabeth Strout, Elizabeth Strout, Paul Harding, Paul Harding, Paul Harding. And, you know, I sort of, you know, looked at my laptop, like, you know, I thought my friends, you know, like, where's the hidden camera, you know? And then in that moment, because they don't call you ahead of time, they don't warn you, there's nothing, it just hits you. And as I sort of fell off my couch, you know, and was just thinking, geez, I just won the Pulitzer. You know, 90 seconds later, the Associated Press is on the phone saying, how do you feel? And I was blah, 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 you know, just had no idea. It was just the strangest thing.
Who was the first person you told?
I don't know. I think I called my wife. I called my wife, and then my editor called, and she just screamed and screamed and screamed. And then it was strange because I was away from my wife and my children out in Iowa, living in this terrible little one-room efficiency teaching, and kind of I'd reverted back to almost like a bachelor, you know. And so I didn't have any clean laundry or a razor blade, you know. And so suddenly the governor of Iowa's, you know, assistant was saying the governor would like to do a photo op with you at the State House, and I had to say, I don't have any clean clothes or a razor, you know. It was just completely.
Did it change your relationship with your peers? Did you find that you suddenly had a lot more friends than you remembered having?
Oh, hey, I've been meaning to catch up with you. A little bit, not really. It's like I said, it can be competitive, and so.
Also, Iowa City is a town full of writers. Iowa City is a town full of writers.
Iowa City is a town for writers, and so there were. I mean, close friends were very happy. The IR Writers Workshop was very happy because I think something like 39 or 40 people have won Pulitzers from there. And then there are a lot of people who are like, congratulations. I'm so happy for you. And then I remember, not long after that, these things kind of happen in clusters. Like, I couldn't get published. I was paying my mortgage with a credit card. I was, you know, tying duct tape around the engine of my car, you know, sort of like, I'm an artist, you know, I'm stuck. Within 2 weeks, the book, I won a Guggenheim, a Pulitzer, and this thing called the Penn Robert Bingham Award.
And 2 years later, you won an Italian award.
What?
You won.
Oh, that too, yeah. I mean, and so it was just like, it all happened in like 10 days, and it's all downhill from there. But it was interesting because I went to a Penn America award ceremony not long after, and I was being introduced as a Pulitzer Prize winner and all of this, and I'm looking in the front row, and there's like Philip Roth and Don DeLillo and, you know, all these people who haven't won the, you know, these tons and tons of books, and they're all just like, yeah, kid, get lost, you know, just so it's there. My learning curve was very steep. I quickly found out that there are two equally bad reactions to winning the Pulitzer. One is to act like you deserve it, and the other is to act like you don't deserve it. So it's sort of.
Did it, after the hullabaloo had subsided a little, did it actually make any difference to your perception of yourself?
No, it didn't make any, I understood, you know, I won it when I was 42 or something like that. I had been a drummer in a rock band for many years. I had spent years traveling around North America and Europe playing music. It was, you know, hard rock, but, you know, whatever. I'd gone around. I'd done lots of tours. I had actually done press junkets and all that sort of stuff. I'd been knocked around. You know, once you've been abused in the English rock and roll music press, you know, like a bad... So I could put it in perspective. I was a first-time author, but I'd knocked around a little bit. And I had been a bookseller, and I had watched all these prizes kind of come and go. And so I knew enough at that point to know that when this happens, it's sort of this larger phenomenon that just sort of befalls you, and you sort of become the protagonist of it for a year. You know, so it was a little like Miss Universe or something. I had the tia and the roses. And then you have to give it back a year later. And so you sort of know it's not me. But, I mean, it's interesting because you have to, it's a combination of it's not you, but it should be you, because you can't just get up there and have a shtick or something. It's a combination of professionalism and I'm an artist, you know, and I believe deeply in art and creativity. And when I go and do events, it has to actually be you, you know, I didn't feel like it changed me personally.
What about reviewers? Do you find that the reviews you got before you won the Pulitzer for the same book, and were they different from the reviews you got after the Pulitzer for the same book?
Yeah, well, for the second book, everybody's sharpening their knives, like, you know, they're just ready for the... I don't know. I mean, that's another one of those things. It's impossible for me to sort of... judge it other than sort of...
You already told us what you thought of the rejection letters.
It's that strange thing. When I read a bad review, I reject bad reviews, too. Yeah. You know, it's like, what are you talking about? What do you know? And I feel like I'm actually amenable to good bad reviews, but I haven't seen one yet. So I understand it's sort of this rationalization issue. I was lucky, though, with the second book in that a larger publishing house, Random House, bought the second book, Enon. It's called Enon. Not only before the Pulitzer won the Pulitzer, I mean, before Tinkers won the Pulitzer, but also the editor at Random House who bought Enon hadn't read Tinkers. So then when all this sort of stuff happened to Tinkers, and, you know, Tinkers just became a kind of phenomenon that had its own kind of gravitational pull, whenever I was worried about that and just getting self-conscious about now, how do I follow up the first book, I just went back to the first 50 pages on the basis of which the editor had bought the second book, and just really went, you know, just sort of forced myself to climb down into that world and stay there. And that was just a skill that I had to sort of learn on the fly after the Pulitzer, which was just to... And I'd already done it. You have to do that as an artist anyways, which is just, you have to block the outside world out to the extent, you know, that you can, and try to climb down into the work of art, and because just on the basis that the work of art is its own best authority, and that its own internal and aesthetic integrity is generated from the inside out rather than externally dictated.
One of the things that resonated for me when I was reading about you was that you mentioned your children. You have two children.
Yeah, two sons.
And you were also caring for them while writing. And there's an increasingly pervasive idea that, you know, the pram and the hall is the enemy of writing.
I reject that utterly.
Excellent.
I do. And I mean, in the United States, it's kind of like the Ernest Hemingway, you know, it's very macho.
Where's my shotgun?
And very like, you know, children will only slow you down. I couldn't have written my books without my kids. They were research, you know. and it's also, there's nothing more humbling than becoming a parent. You know, you realize how much, I realized when I became a parent, how much time I had wasted thinking about myself, you know, my own, my problems. And also just how much time I had wasted. And so I wrote Tinkers when my wife had our first child. I was working, teaching full-time undergraduate at Harvard University, teaching part-time at night, and we had our first son, and then we had our second son within 2 or 3 years. And so I just did it with, you know, just juggling the children. I got so I could write fiction while my children were crawling over me, you know, just sort of. Part of that also had to do with I was so busy that really I reduced the whole process of writing down to one sentence at a time. just write one sentence at a time, then the next sentence, then the next sentence, which was already sort of a piece with the way that I write is very intuitive, improvisational, and very interrogative. I always write in order to discover what the next sentence is. I don't write declarative prose. Usually if I feel like, if I wake up in the morning and feel like I already know what it is that I'm going to write, it's probably not even worth typing up, you know.
Yeah. I managed to read a copy of Tinker's yesterday. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful, beautiful book. I'd recommend it to all of you. And it there's a presence of mind as opposed to voice. And one of the people that I spoke to about your work also, we discussed that. So when you read prose here, often you are struck by the voice. But when I read your book, I was struck by mind, you know?
It all sort of telescopes, but to me, I'm not interested in plot. I'm interested in writing about human beings. I'm interested in writing about character. To me, the hallmark of character is consciousness. It's the hallmark of consciousness is mind, it's being in time, it's memory, and it's perception. So I want my books to read as if you are experiencing another consciousness. And Tinker's, it's sort of a familial consciousness. One of the things I did was I made the three protagonists, say, are all men in the same family, and I made their consciousness permeable. So the sort of the point of view, it's like almost osmosis. The narrative moves in and out of what is this kind of larger familial consciousness. But I do. I'm interested in mind. I'm interested in the primacy of experience and of mind. I write experiential prose. You know, I never mean to dictate or to write declarative prose or to write I guess declarative or explanatory. Hmm. I mean for my work to just be no more, no less than descriptions of experience that approach something like the complexity of actually being conscious, you know.
Is that maturity of approach something that you've always had, or did it have to do with the fact that you spent, you know, your early 20s being a drummer in a rock band and perhaps maybe grew?
I don't know. Yeah, I think it's just always that. I mean, it's sort of the cultural milieu out of which, you know, I grew up in New England, which is that kind of old Protestant sort of, it's the I and thou. It's you know, you have been privileged enough to be given your own, you have your given humanity, and what you are meant to do with that is to live, you know, it's the considered life. It's a very provincial, localized version of the considered life. The idea that you've been given this experience and your job is to be thoughtful about it and to meditate on it. And so when I think of, you know, Tinker's, for example, is very, very steeped in the local landscape. But I don't ever write about landscape per se. So there's a lot of pastoralism. It's sort of lyrical, pastoral. But it's never just to write about the sunlight going through the creek water and the birch. I call it birch bark metaphysics, you know. But it's never meant to merely be landscape. It's landscape is refracted through the perception of it as a means of illuminating character.
Okay. Everybody got that?
It's quite simple. I can. I come from such a provincial place that I think everybody knows this already. So I come to Islamabad and say, don't you know you're Ralph Waldo Emerson? You know, but there is this tradition of this transcendentalism, this New England transcendentalism, which is very much Herman Melville, Hawthorne, all of these writers. So it's just very experiential. And the other thing is just, your job is to, under no circumstances are you ever to try to coerce anybody else into, coerce anybody else or demand of them that they make of their experience what you make of yours. So that's that, again, that interrogative as opposed to propaganda.
Yeah.
You know.
So the other prizes that you won, the Penn Robert W. Bingham Award in 2010,
yeah.
And then the Italian Award, mm-hmm. which is an award to celebrate American literature in Italy.
In Italy, yeah.
Do they feel different every time you win something?
Yeah, they do. I mean, every time I win something, I'm just sort of, I still feel like somebody's playing a practical joke on me. One of my friends from home is playing a practical joke on me. But it's just always very humbling. You know, I feel like it's just a vote of confidence from a group of peers or so people have taken your work to heart. And they have the opportunity to offer you this award as a token of, you know, they feel, I take it as people have read my art and they feel like it's been written in good faith, and that the any kind of a prize or anything is just a token of an encouragement to keep writing in good faith, you know?
That's a great way to look at it. But there's a bit of kerfuffle about prizes in general. The Pulitzer is only open to Americans.
Right.
And a couple of years ago, the Booker Prize, which is a huge award in Europe,
right,
open to Americans.
Yeah.
And Europe and the Commonwealth, what used to be the Commonwealth, we're not happy.
Just I apologize on behalf of America. What? How do I feel?
From America, what did it look like?
I mean, I don't know. I mean, on the one level, the Pulitzers, it's their prerogative to give it to whoever they want. I feel with the Booker, there's the and now is it the it's the Folio Prize. It's a new prize that was instituted, I think, in order to remedy what it saw as the exclusion of American writers from the Booker. I don't know. I mean, it just has to be very, I mean, my opinion about these things is very, very anecdotal. I mean, because I grew up, when I worked in bookstores, you just read, every year you read the Pulitzer, the Booker, and just, you know, any prize that you heard of was just generally a good guide to, this is a book that's worth your attention for one reason or another. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think there's a lot to be said for keeping certain book prizes regional, because then you know that it's just you're going to get at least a book that was widely considered worthy of attention from a particular place in a particular time, as opposed to if it's wide open. As we said earlier, these things are very political, and I mean the Booker from the United States, the Booker looks like nothing could be more political than the Booker. I mean, it's just. And because I think is the Booker, you know who the jury is beforehand.
Yes.
And the Pulitzer, they have to sign non-disclosure agreements, and they only announce the jury afterwards. So the Booker seems like it's much more kind of wide open. Kind of it's almost like controversy is sort of built into it.
It is, and there are questions about the makeup of the jury and the prevalence of white older men of
alas.
Certain class.
Yeah.
Partly in response to that, there's also now, and there has been for several years, a prize for women's fiction.
The Orange Prize?
It used to be the Orange Prize, it's now the Bailey's Prize. A huge influence on you when you were at the Iowa Writers' Workshop was Marilyn Robinson.
She's my mentor.
Who's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful writer.
Astonishing, yeah.
Do you have an opinion on prizes specifically for women? I mean, for me, it seems to be like a, what?
I don't know. I mean,
why are we not allowed to compete on a level playing field?
I don't know, because Marilyn has also won every other
single
award that you possibly could. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'd like to think, you know, if there's an award for women, is it because I want to think that it comes out of some gesture of trying to redress a perceived imbalance. I don't know, I don't know enough about the Orange Prize to, because I certainly don't feel excluded from it because I'm a man, you know, I sort of feel like, so I don't know. I mean, I just haven't really thought about it. Because I feel like in the United States, the Pulitzer Prize juries is often consist of women as they consist of men.
And it changes every year, right?
And it changes every year. There's three different judges every year. I feel like, Donna Tartt won last year. Jennifer Egan won the year before. There's a fair balance. I mean, I think these things are always, they're always imperfect. They always need to be re-examined. They always need to keep their processes open, and they're always almost inevitably going to sort of be behind the times just because they're institutional and they're reacting to,
yeah,
you know.
So my final question to you on the prize before we move on to other things is the practical difference it made in terms of, sorry, your financial situation and the sales of your book?
You want to know about the money?
Yeah.
Is that how it works? well, the prize money isn't that much. The financial windfall for the Pulitzer, which I don't think happens comparably with any of the other prizes, is just in sales. So, for example, I mean, Tinkers was never really published in hardcover; it was just in paperback. Before the Pulitzer, it sold about 12,000 copies, which is very good in the United States for a quote-unquote, you know, literary first novel, that sort of thing. Since the Pulitzer Prize, it has sold, in the United States anyway, something like 600,000 copies. And that's sort of by far the most, I'm by far the most lowly Pulitzer Prize, I'm like the least of the Pulitzers. I think they regularly sell 1.5 or 2 million copies afterwards. It just comes from royalties that way. But then it has a half life. It falls off. It falls off after a while.
Okay. Yeah. Why don't we open the floor to questions? If anybody has any questions for Paul.
Thank you very much, Paul, for your very excellent presentation. I'm sorry I didn't read your
novel. Sorry, one second. There's going to be...
Before we start the question and answer session, we would appreciate if you can only keep your questions precise and short and kindly refrain from making any outrageous statement. Thank you.
That doesn't apply to you, Paul.
I was going to say, can I make outrageous statements? I wouldn't be able to...
Well, I'm sorry I didn't read your novel, but we have one thing in common. You teach at Harvard, and I was a student there 30 years ago.
Oh, no kidding. Yeah.
So my question is that I have been visiting USA frequently, and my concern is that the bookstores, either they are closing down or shrinking. For example, Border closed down, was one of the biggest. And last year I went to Barnes & Noble, and they shrank. They almost did it half of their... bookstore, and they brought in toys and tea and something like that, coffee.
Yeah.
So what do you think, how is it affecting the authors, and how do you see 10 years down the line, there will be any bookstore in USA, or it will be all e-books?
I don't know. I mean, I think the pressure on bookstores, what I've found in maybe the last 10 years is you had all the independent bookstores, and then the big bookstore chains came along, like Barnes & Noble. There was a chain called Borders. I think in like the UK there was Waterstones or something. And so then that was going to be the death of the independent bookstore, because Barnes & Noble was going to crush everything. And then Amazon came along and actually destroyed all the really big bookstore chains, so that now, yeah, Barnes & Noble still has the same cubic footage, but now they just have 12,000 copies of the five most famous books at any given time, rather than a depth of stock. One of the things about that is that it's actually made it, it seems to have made space again for small independent bookstores again. It's still tough though, because it's tough to get, like, say, for a small independent bookstore to afford real estate space in New York City. I mean, it's just very difficult. It's just an ongoing thing. With e-books, I'm not sure. I don't know. I mean, I'm sort of a generation, you know, and I don't mean to be romantic about it, to me it's got to be a book. It has to be for it to kind of exist, I need to be able to hold it. There's something aesthetic about it or whatever. But I have no objection. Like, if people are still writing good books, I don't care if people read my books on an e-tablet. You know, I also think that we're still kind of in the middle of sort of e-books and e-readers just sort of it's like water finding its own level. I think it'll sort of level off at a certain point. I don't know, because I think my feeling is that in the United States, everywhere, is that there are as many, if not more, wonderful books being written than ever. In the United States, it's more just like, how do you choose among them, and how do they make it to market? How do they make it? How are they brought to the attention of the most serious readers? You know.
question is, who did you write for in the first place? And who should one write for to win some prize?
Who should win prizes?
Who should you write for to win a prize?
Oh, who you should write for yourself. I mean, it's a strange thing. It's one of the things I love about art is that art not only accepts, but it embraces paradox. And one of the things that I found is that the best way to be solicitous of the reader is to not think of her or him at all while I'm writing. I just try to write the absolute best book that I can, and try to have faith in the fact that if I can write a book that I want to read, there'll be other people who want to read it. As an author, you have to be very careful too, because you can anticipate criticism and you can end up writing, instead of writing the real book, you can write in anticipation of antagonism. And so it sounds very counterintuitive, but one of the things I always tell my writing students is, always write your books, three of the things I always tell them is, you know, write the kind of book that you'd like to read. Always write your books for the smartest readers you can imagine. Don't write down to your readers. Always presume they're smarter than you are. And don't write your books for the people who won't like them. It's the strangest thing, you know. So I write my birch bark metaphysics. If I pulled back on that, I'm only going to make the people who like birch bark metaphysics mad. You know, readers will self-select. So I just always try to, you know, write. And just as a writer, I'm just trying to reproduce as a writer for my readers the experience I like most as a reader, which are those moments where you get finished with a book, a chapter, a passage, even a single sentence, and you just have to put the book down, and all at once you think to yourself, that's absolutely true. I've always known it's true. I've never seen anybody put it into words. Those moments of recognition, of revelation, you know. Oh, in academia, that's a whole
Yeah,
I heard academia, no.
I have a question. You said that you won quite a number of awards immediately after you won the Pulitzer.
Yeah,
my question, please don't mind, but would you have managed to win so many awards if you hadn't won the Pulitzer?
It's an excellent question. Sometimes there is a sense that it takes awards to win awards, and sometimes if people are not sure whether or not to give you an award, they look to see if you have awards, in which case you're worthy of an award. You know, it is. It's a kind of involuted. In my case, it was just absurd because I went from absolute, total, 100% obscurity to the Pulitzer. There was backlash to that, you know, I mean, just with the second book to some extent, you know, it's just, you just know it's going to happen. It's just, it's a law of physics or a law of the, you know, I think one of the prizes, Guggenheim, I actually won before the Pulitzer, then the Pulitzer happened. I just think in my case, it's, the book Tinkers in particular just happened to sort of insinuate itself in the literary culture of America in a particular way that's almost, you couldn't deliberately plan it. I was just incredibly fortunate for it to happen. And it is, it's the kind of thing that, you know, in the United States, and it happens every 10 years. You think, oh, that guy who wrote that book, and it came out of nowhere, nobody would, and what, it just happened that I was the protagonist of that story for one of the cycles, sort of. I'd love another award if somebody wants to give me. No, you know what I mean? The second book came out, and everybody's like, sort of, oh, great. Now you're, you know, now I'm just sort of back in the scrum, as it were. You know, so yeah.
Peter.
With what effectiveness and how effectively can you, a work of fiction, life writing can be made to merge into a work of fiction, given the fact that there's such a thing as sincerity of voice? How effectively can you make a life writing experience merge into a work of fiction?
How effectively can...
Can you make a life writing experience merge into a work?
How effectively can you make a life writing experience
into a work of fiction?
into a work of fiction. Basically, he's asking about your process.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sorry, and it's because I was a drummer for many years. I'm deaf. I'm clinically deaf. I can't understand, you know, Boston English very well. I can't hear it very well. It's interesting because I when I started trying to write, Tinkers was originally, I tried to write it as a memoir about my grandfather, with whom I was very, very close. He was like my father to me. And when I started trying to write up my experience having him as my grandfather, what I found was that when I wrote it as nonfiction, I lost the ability to assign relative weight to different subjects. Everything was of the utmost importance because he was my grandfather. Once I sort of took a little step back and made my grandfather into more like a fictional character or a voice that I distanced slightly from who he really was, then I could start actually writing about kind of the spiritual truth that was closer to what I thought about his life and his own father's life and all that sort of stuff. And so then it just becomes a matter of imagination. You know, I don't know, in the United States, the imagination, I feel, you know, I'm an artist, so now I got you to, but the imagination is sort of under siege, at least, you know, in the United States, is this sort of like vestigial kind of ability that sort of, it's considered sort of navel gazing, it's considered extraneous. But the imagination to me is, it's one of the greatest human abilities. You know, it's one of the greatest abilities that humans have. It's a great epistemological tool. It's a great means. It's as great a means for investigating meaning in human life as anything else. And so to cultivate it, I mean, I'm just always trying to imagine my way into other people's lives and trying to become, I climb down into the fictional world. And I consider myself kind of an amanuensis. I'm just there to take dictation. So I feel like what I do is I take my pad and my pen and I go down into the world and I just shut up and I listen very closely and I watch very closely and I just write down what it is that I find and try not to impose my will on these characters. Now, it's all very, you know, I don't mean to be tricky or coy about it, but it's... just habituating yourself to listening to, in my case, it's fictional characters, but it then extends out into the real world of habituating yourself to listening to people listening to and authenticating people's accounts of their own humanity, and not dictating humanity to people, but listening and just and being humble in the presence of people naming their own experience, and as an artist, I habituate myself to doing that every single day, so that then when I go back out in my sort of as a citizen or whatever, I just find that I'm much more liable to extend that courtesy to other people just in my day-to-day life, to the extent that I try to just make it so that there's no discrepancy between my walking around time as a citizen and my time as a writer. They become indistinguishable. I don't know if that quite answers the question, but it's hopefully the spirit of the thing is there, you know.
Hi.
Oh, hi.
How are you?
I'm well.
Okay. Actually, my son wants me to ask you this question.
Yeah.
That how has writing novels changed your perception towards the world and mortality now?
Mortality. Well, I'm endlessly fascinated with mortality. In the United States, anyways, people. One of the questions people always come up to me, and they always ask, "Why do you write about death?" And I just, you know, well, I don't write about death. I write about life and the fact that you know we are immortal, and we have faith, or you know, we have various faiths to varying degrees at varying times of what occurs at the end of our mortal career, you know, and there's nothing more profound upon which to meditate, you know, and so for these earthly careers, to me, that, you know, the mortality is just, it's if anything, just dramatically speaking, it's the ultimate backdrop against which to set life in relief, you know. And so writing novels has just been a process of just taking my deepest intuitions that I received from reading. You know, I was a reader first, And I think like a lot of writers, I began to write when my reading kind of hit critical mass. And when I think of, you know, I try to write what I think of as literary fiction, and my kind of operating definition of literary fiction is simply fiction that is in response to and in dialogue with other writing. You know, and I, you know, to me it's other art. I'm a great fan of music. I'm a great fan of jazz music. I've spent many nights in clubs listening to jazz musicians. I love painting. I love sculpture. You know, music, just pour it all in. Because I feel like it is it's a privilege to be a part of this ongoing conversation that's not only across cultures but across times. You know, because when I sit down and say read St. Augustine, or I read John Milton, say, or whatever, you know, for all intents and purposes, when I open that book and start reading, we are contemporaries. I'm now a contemporary with St. Augustine. We are existing at the same time. And so that's just, that's just endlessly fascinating. I'm a metaphysician. It's just my natural disposition, you know? And I'm discursive, too, in case you didn't notice.
Hello, Paul, thank you for being here, and I hope you're having a good time in Pakistan.
I'm having a great time. It's wonderful to be here.
Paul, being a first-time writer and someone looking at you, one feels that you take yourself not that seriously, maybe, you know, how you're creating your work. But what is hard to actually put all these things in order, but what do you think really is the thing for a writer of your age from this generation? Mm-hmm. Is it the acceptance, or is it finding an audience? Is it being able to express, or is it survival? I know all these factors do come in while you're putting in a work of art,
mm-hmm.
but what really drives you? Because you told that you write sentence to sentence.
Yeah.
So what is that is at the back of your mind while you're doing your creative work? Thank you.
It's looking for a certain... there's all sorts of different contexts, but, you know, it's looking for a certain quality of truth. It's aesthetic truth, you know. It's happening in an aesthetic context, you know. But it goes back to having been an avid reader, and going back to when I read Thomas Mann, when I read Tolstoy, when I read when I read all these people, and understanding, you know, when I interact with great works of art. And again, it's literature, but it can be painting, it can be movies, it can be music. But just the quality of experience that I have when I'm in the presence of a great work of art, I got so, as a consumer, as it were, of art, as a listener of music, a reader of literature, I was able to sort of, I can vet a work of art. I can understand when I'm in the presence of world-class art. Even whether or not it's even a matter of personal taste, I can understand that there's a certain level of art in which that I'm in the presence of. And so when I make my own art, it's just actually trying to listen for and trying to push. In my case, the medium is language. So I take the English language and I put aesthetic pressure on it, and I try to push it past the limit of received opinion, popular thinking, truism, platitude, headlines, you know, that sort of stuff, I just try to make every single sentence I write true. Which is not, you know, it's fiction, so it's not factual truth, it's imaginative truth. But I think we often, at least in the United States, often think of fact as a straight-up synonym for truth, which, start talking about politics with anybody and think, you're crazy, how can you think that's true? You know what I mean? The truth exists. The truth as lived or as experienced internally is largely a function of the imagination. And so I'm just always trying to explore that, you know, just as a writer. I mean, I'm self-deprecating because part of what I'm serious about is the art. You know, when I'm writing, it is utterly without, I mean, I try to shed my ego, I try to shed myself. One of the ways that when I revise, one of the things I listen for in trying to find truth as a poet, you know, is I actually listen for my own voice. And the moment I feel like I can hear my own voice in my writing, I know it's gone off the rails and I'm grinding axes and seeking revenge or trying to show everybody how smart I am or funny I am. And when the writing is at the level I want it to be, I can't recognize the fact that I wrote it. It turns into something that's, you know, it seems to have somehow or another transcended my own sort of more mundane kind of likes and dislikes.
That's beautifully put. I think we just have time for one question, two questions. Can we have the gentleman in the back? He's had his hand up for about 20 minutes. Sir, aap aage aa jaye. Aur ek aur aur phir. Bahut hai, this is great. I'm really happy to see such an engaged audience. Paul, this is because of you.
No, it's because of you.
No,
really,
these things are. Like we're being massaged by
no, if everybody was sort of sitting there like, you know, I'd be. It would be. It's much.
She'll give you a mic.
Hello, Paul.
Hi.
Thank you for your time. My question is about evolution of English language. I don't know if you've come up with the terms like Americanisms and the cliches.
Mm-hmm.
After the text speak, they call it text speech.
Yeah,
writing used to be formal, it's not anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And slowly it's become a part of the literature as well. A lot of linguists like Chomsky call it pollution.
Sir, I'm going to start yelling at you
language.
If you don't get to your
Should
question.
We accept it as it is and not find it disturbing to as a part of the language? Or it can be isolated?
You mean that you know the degradation of the language?
The words like swag and OMG, you know, you're seeing someone.
Yeah, like text, like, level of the text.
The new writers have adopted it, and
yeah.
If you read fiction, it's very frequent.
I don't know. I mean, I have to answer that anecdotally, as I have to answer everything. I mean, I have no objection to texting and all that, you know, because I have young sons, and they do it, and I text them, and it's just a kind of convenient way to sort of. But to me, it's just informal. It's ephemera. I'm interested in artists who want to turn it into art. You know, Twitter. You know, can you write a 140 character poem? Great, you know, but the danger is then that you lose the ability to express yourself precisely, and you lose the ability to think precisely, and what you end up doing is you just end up thinking in, you know, people sort of have groupthink sort of, you know, and the language degrades. I mean, I just feel like part of my, it's not like my mission as a writer or whatever, it's just a natural disposition, but there's somewhat of an antidote against that in that I'm always looking for, I mean, English is a very rich language, so I sort of read the dictionary while I'm eating my cereal in the morning, not to find exotic words, but always understanding that there is always a precise word for exactly whatever it is that I need to find on the page, and always trying to keep the language alive in terms of that. And so I feel like Tinkers and Enon are, they're for people who care about language, you know, and care about, and are not, don't mind finding some words they might not know. For me, the criteria is if I'm going to make you look a word up, it's just that when you look the word up and find the definition and then take it back to the text, it's exactly what it means, and you think, oh, great, so it deepens your understanding, it deepens the nuance of the meaning of the text, rather than there's Paul Harding with all of his 10-cent words. You know, like, and that goes back to that idea of, you know, the aesthetic, the difference in, you know, those kind of novels, I think, you know, my version of that is think, you know, there's the type of novel where you finish it and your feeling is not, oh, I've just read a great work of art. Your feeling is, oh, isn't author X, Y, or Z the smartest little thing I've ever come across? You know, writing that just sort of like demonstrates the brilliance of the writer rather than writing that is, it feels like it's a work of art. That's one of the distinctions I would make for sure, yeah.
Hello, I have a small question. Just wanted to know, I haven't read the books yet.
You wouldn't believe what I haven't read.
No.
You,
I haven't
worry,
read the book, but I just wanted to know why the title Tinker.
Why the title Tinkers? Oh, yeah. That's great. Partially because the original title was so embarrassing that I would never, ever utter it. And that, you know, like I burned every reference. It was just very terrible. This is another example, actually, interestingly enough, of how provincial I am and where I come from is because in the part of New England I'm from, a tinker is a very generic, no value, just value neutral term for somebody who's like a very modest door-to-door peddler or salesperson. In the United States, my great-grandfather was what was called a fuller brush salesman. And he actually had a little cart that he went around with, very, very impoverished rural Maine out in the woods. And you'd sell, you'd go to houses and it was mostly selling to women. And it was, you know, you'd sell the women their buckets and their mops and their brushes. It turns out that tinkers has all sorts of other meanings. Like I was horrified to find out, you know, in Ireland, it's a racial slur against gypsies. You know, so I couldn't wait to get to Ireland and get on stage and say, I'm sorry. You know, I mean, they knew that it had different meanings. But, and so there's the literal sense, tinkers. I also think of it as a verb tense, like tinkers, he tinkers, we one of the protagonists repairs clocks. So there's that idea of but there's also the idea of just negotiating your own mortality as you're tinkering. You know, you're always kind of improvising and trying to come up with solutions and trying to sort of fit things together so they sort of click and make sense and don't kind of blow up in your face, you know, that sort of thing. And so just that idea that we're all sort of improvising as we go along and doing the best we can to make coherent, you know, coherent little doodads of our lives or whatever. You know, the metaphor breaks down if I go too far with it, but it's meant to be kind of open like that.
Okay, I'm going to have a maximum of three more questions and we're going to end, but before you go to your question, I'd just like to say I've been listening to you, and like most people in this room, I feel enlivened by your vocabulary, and I've been thinking of this line from David Grossman listening to you speak, which is, sometimes the correct and precise use of language can be like a balm to a wound.
I feel like that's true, and that's what I even mean about, you know, writing about what's true, saying what's true, not letting you know, prefabricated, off-the-rack phraseology suffice, yeah. Because I just feel like that's where a lot of misadventure takes place, and where a lot of complicity takes place. You know, not settling for anything less than the most precise expression possible. You know.
Yeah.
I mean, I've been thinking about Ralph Waldo Emerson because he, you know, and I feel like it's, I mean, it's not, I'm incredibly humbled to be in Islamabad. It's just astonishing for me to be here. And one of the things I kept thinking on the plane ride over is an aphorism by Ralph Waldo Emerson, one of my favorite thinkers, who says, "Those who are unwise at home are unlikely to be made wise by going abroad." And I kept thinking, oh, here you go, you know.
All right. Would you like to go first? Yeah.
Okay. I had this question. Has any Hollywood producer contacted you to adapt your book into a movie? And if not, if they do, I mean, how much involved?
No. No, go ahead. I'm sorry. Finish.
No, I was just saying, if they haven't contacted you up till now, if they do in the near future, how much involvement would you have in the movie making for that because of your book adaptation?
Right. One movie maker did approach, and I... it was just strange. I got on the phone with him and all his lawyers, and I was working on. So the two novels are actually interconnected. They're not sequential. You can read them each separately, but they take place the same family in the same fictional town, which is Enon, the title of the second book. And what it turns out is that when Hollywood buys rights to a property, they don't buy rights to the book; they buy rights to the characters. And so the lawyers that were on this conference call, when we were talking about Tinkers and I was writing Enon, they said, well, you need to send us whatever you have of Enon so we can start making sure that it works with what we... And I just said, I'm a novelist. I'm not writing a screenplay for you to option. One of the things is, you know, I have friends who have had books made into movies, and one of the things they say is, what you have to understand is if you sign off on a movie, first of all, you'll make more money than you ever made as a writer, so there's that. That's the upside. But the second part of it is, your book will not be made into a movie. you know, if you're lucky, a good movie will be made that was inspired by your book. Like, don't go looking to see your book on the screen. You'll only die of heartbreak before the first reel's done. You know, that sort of thing. For my part, it's, and again, I'm not strident about it, but I take, it's not even pride, because I don't have to deliberately do it. You know, I'm just dispositionally, these are the types of novels that I write. But I kind of like the fact that I don't think you could film Tinkers.
I don't think you can film Tinkers either, unless it's waves. But I mean,
because it's just very interior. Yeah. It's all experiential. So it's sort of Enon, you possibly could, but it would be a guy lying on a couch, you know. So, you know, anyway. But so I kind of like the idea that I'm a novelist who writes novels that are, you know. Because so many novels now, you feel like they signed the movie deal before they even wrote the novel. And I don't, you know, more power to you, that sort of thing. But I like the idea that I write things that are just, it's just, they are works of art that are absolutely, kind of exclusively of the medium and of the idiom in which they were created, you know.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
So, Mr. Hardy, you were speaking of the language, and you know, when you were talking of your kids and all, I don't know why, but I remembered of Sylvia Plath, and she says that, you know, my kids are crying and I can't write, and you know, I don't have the time and all that. So, you know, all the words that you could not write, you know, at some point in time, it just hits you that this is, you know, all right, the next sentence is this one. And if you couldn't write it and you forgot, how do you kind of deal with that frustration?
That's a good question. You have to be sort of melancholic, I guess, to be, you know, you do sort of feel like there are just oceans of beautiful stories and sentences and words that you're never going to capture and get down on paper. But what I do is I just think that what persists is maybe not, you know, any given sentence might fly out the window while I'm washing the dishes or running after one of my sons because he's lit something on fire or something, is that I persist, and that my own sort of obsessions, my own aesthetic obsessions persist, and that if I don't get it this time, sooner or later I'm going to loop back to what's truly important to me. And so far it's just always been the case that that happens. And it just keeps you going, you know. You feel the ones that cut. Because I think another thing is, I write, I'm very idealistic. I feel like somewhere out in the universe there is the perfect version of Tinkers, and boy, I didn't get it down, you know. And somewhere there was a perfect version of Enon, and so you can always try to do it better. There's, you know, like there's that sentence, there's that sentence, but then I had to go pick up my kids at football, you know, and then I lost it. But I think. The same idea will come back around, and maybe I'll get it better than I ever could have imagined. So it's that idea of, it's just there's a kind of a intensity. You just habituate yourself to always thinking and always engaging and about thinking about your art during every waking minute. You habituate yourself to it, and you're just always putting pressure on your own thinking and on the language, and just always trying to be as mindful as possible. And even then you understand it's all just going to be kind of leaking away. And you just, hopefully what you do catch on the page is indicative of everything else too. It feels like even, you know, I've got 150 pages down with Tinkers, but hopefully, I always think, you know, what I'm always going for is Tinkers is 150 pages long, but I hope it's 2,000 pages deep. You know, the idea that, like, it sets much more than its literal length resonating in the character.
Actually, I was struck by that, too. It's about 191 pages and 40,000 words, 42,000 words.
About 40,000.
And we live in an age where people think that you have to write 80,000 words.
Yeah,
words.
Yeah. Which
What's
I,
up with that?
You know, yeah. I like maximum density, too.
Yeah.
Maximum density coupled with maximum lucidity. clarity, you know. I feel very democratic that way. You know, the idea that I want to write about the profoundest things in a sophisticated manner as they can be put onto the page in the English language, but in a way that as many people as possible could read them and feel included within within the radius of their ideas.
All right, we're going to have one last question. And I'm not, but Paul, it's your job to pick one of these hands.
Oh, no, oh my gosh, no, I can't, I'm sorry, I can't do that.
We're not that heartless.
Hi, I want to ask that, did you feel any sort of limitations while expressing your art?
Any sort of limitation internally or externally or, you know, in the United States, I mean, the only external limitations would be, you know, thinking about the marketplace, thinking about peers, thinking about sort of, you know, being hip, being relevant, you know, none of those, I'm bothered by none of those things. You know, my Tinkers was, you know, people think of Tinkers as very archaic sounding. People would say, how did you get the book to sound so old? And I just had everybody, I wrote in grammatically correct English, you know, without the OMGs and all that sort of stuff. I don't know, you know, the limitations just, I mean, I have the luxury of, you know, my limitations are my own. And I have the freedom and the luxury of being able to contemplate them at great length every day. I mean, I feel like my job every day is to get up and confront my own limitations of what I can think and what I can write. Those are the only limitations I feel.
I want to ask that what you wanted in your mind, did you display that in your character as well? Like, it was exact what you think that it would be?
What I think in my mind ends up on the page. No, I mean, this is one of the great mysteries and great pleasures of art too, which is that because you can, there's something different. It's a whole different phenomenon between thinking something up and then precipitating it onto the page in language. I mean, I can come up with, you know, the poem that encapsulates the entire universe in my mind, and then when I go to the keyboard, I back to like, my dog has fleas. You know what I mean? I mean, it's just that strange, mysterious sort of thing. So, but there is such a capacity for meaning in the language that I presume, and like the great pleasure of that I anticipate every time I read is that when I'm writing, I'm consciously pursuing meaning that I'm conscious of which I am conscious. It's almost tautological. But what I know is that at the end of a day's writing, if I say have two pages of writing, more than half of the meaning that got onto the page, it was completely unintentional on my part, and it was completely unconscious. And sometimes, I mean, this is a way you have to be very thoughtful. But sometimes what you were not conscious of as getting on the page is actually what you're really writing about. And what I go back and scrape out is the stuff that I was actually after. And there is this sort of, this aesthetic kind of momentum that the writing and the subject will, if you've been working on, I work on novels, so they're larger, you know, long-term projects. They start to generate their own integrity. It's what physicists call emergent properties, which is the more complicated a system gets, the more aspects and properties that you could never theoretically predict beforehand begin to emerge.
Like, and this question and answer session.
No, it's just beautiful to watch things you never could have intellectually anticipated arrive on the page, and that to me is like that's the artistic part of it. You know.
Thank you.
You're most welcome.
At this point, I'm going to have to, ladies and gentlemen, my apologies, but no more questions. We don't have any more time. But thank you so much, Paul.
Thank you all. It was a great pleasure. My pleasure. Thank you.
And thank you so much. And before you leave, I'd like to let you know that there will be a session at 3:45 in memory of Sabine Mahmood, who is the director of the second floor in Karachi. Please do attend. I think it will be in this room.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Our next session will start at 2:30 p.m. and that will be equally entertaining, hopefully. Thank you.